Welcome to another live edition of Pittsburgh Sportsline in the BPTV studios. Thanks for watching us on Verizon 32 here and all the way to Nemacolin and Cranberry, Wexford. We appreciate you. And thanks for our steady regulars on Comcast 7, only in Bethel Park. We have a great show for you. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. I got Chip Hainer with me. And sad to say, Smoking Jim missed another show. He has permission to start driving. I think he told me June 1st, which is coming up in a couple days, and then he'll be out. So next week, hopefully, we'll get him on a show, Chip.
Love to have him back.
Put him in our prayers. If you could pray for him in any way possible, it'd be great. He says he feels strong, but he got to get his strength back up, and I guess the doctor's okaying him to do a few things, and we'll see if he can do his little explosive opening segment. He may be shut down on that for a while. Well, if the doctor knows about it. My guess is the doctor won't know Smoking Jim broadcast very loudly. But I got a few promos here. First off the bat, thank you, Olive Oils Pizzeria, for being the sponsor of our show. Had a great XL pizza with just great stuff. Call 412-831-1900, Hillcrest Shopping Center. Tell them Al Levine, the talking machine, sent you there to call and then pick up your pizza there, or hoagies, or pasta, whatever you want. Always talk about Joey Strong. Didn't make his ninth birthday. Had brain cancer, DIPG. They have events throughout the year. And if you could donate something to the Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation, even a dollar. Check out different activities they'll have. They'll have a 5K coming up in September, I think. They're making plans for that. Now we got the Bethel Park Historical Society Schoolhouse Arts and History Center, right with the trolley there on South Park Road. Excuse me, you can't miss it. Had a little frog there. Let me get that out of the way. Check out their site. Donate a dollar. Anything to help them out. It's all going to a good cause. It's another 501c3. Another thing, groups can get money. $100 to $5,000 at the Bethel Park Community Foundation.org. BPCF.org. Get an application. Apply for your group. Get some money here for Bethel Park people that are doing some good things out there. I'm a trustee on the group, and we've put out plenty of money out there for people that have got the application. Bring them out. So check that out. There's a fight coming up June 24th, Rumble River 6, Angelo Magnone, Made Men Promotions, is doing it, has a lot of Pittsburgh fighters there. It'll be a great night of fighting alongside the river. What a great venue it is. Check it out, Rivers Casino. Check that out on June 24th. One of Chip's favorites and mine, Uncle Al wants you to be a volunteer at BPTV Studios. Dave Cable put my face in there, if you can see it. It's the best I can do, and I'm there grinning. We want you to be behind the camera like Devin Shea is. Ethan's here tonight. Check it out. Contact Bethel Park BPTV and Dave Cable. Matter of fact, give him a call, 412-831-3304. Hey, that's all I got to hope and promote. And we always talk about what's on your mind. I made Chip wait a little bit, and he's ready, willing, and able with information that's for you guys. And this first thing is, what's on your mind?
Yes,
so we're going to hit that first, and then stay tuned for his trivia segment. That'll be coming up after that.
All righty. Well, thank you, Alan. And just to kind of rehash what I went over last week, had some very strong opinions about the state of the NHL.
Yeah, you did.
The buffoonery of the commissioner of the NHL, Gary Bettman. And I think he's gone ahead and proved my point beyond any question of a doubt. He is absolutely the worst commissioner of any professional sport in North America. What do you think about that?
That's a profound statement.
You know, especially when Roger Goodell is still alive and kicking.
That's what I'm getting at. You haven't picked on him this week.
You know, here we finally have a chance where all the attention is focused on the NHL. And instead of this being the NHL's shining moment with the NHL's face of the NHL player, Sidney Crosby, arguably the best player on the planet, being showcased in the Stanley Cup Finals, he makes comments to the effect that he doesn't see anything wrong with the beatings that he has been taking all throughout the playoffs until finally Jim Rutherford came out in an interview and talked about how everybody is commenting about how much they enjoy the way the Pittsburgh Penguins play hockey. The one thing you always hear the Penguins head coach Mike Sullivan say is that when you play the game the right way, and when we play the right way, they generally win. Well, there's a right way to play the games, and then there's the Goons' way of playing the games, which was the way the game was played in the 70s and 80s. But, you know, life is evolution, and sports have evolved. So, baseball to less of a degree, but look what's happened to the game of football. Football has evolved to try to make it more friendly for the participants because people were getting their brains scrambled, bodies broken up.
Plus lawsuits, I think, were coming about.
Hell yeah. Well, you know, but
that sort of helped move it along.
You know, maybe that's what somebody from the NHLPA should think about, is dropping a few lawsuits on the NHL because they don't have pockets as deep as the NFL. But, you know, if the commissioner of the league doesn't see that there's a problem with the way things are being done, and the fact that the referees are keeping their whistles in their pockets instead of calling flagrant fouls that are obvious to everybody that's watching the games, I don't think they need to make a whole bunch of new rules. All they have to do is enforce the ones that exist. And my point is, if the commissioner of the league doesn't seem to think that there's a problem, how is the problem going to get addressed, and how are they going to make this game more enjoyable for more people to watch? Hockey is a great game. It's nonstop action. It's hard hitting. You do not have to deliberately hit people in the head, scramble their brains, have all this retaliation stuff. The game is really enjoyable. If you don't believe me, watch any of the Olympic hockey tournaments. Yeah. Fighting is not allowed. And they're actually very entertaining. Lots of action, lots of scoring.
Great playmaking.
Hockey is a very skilled sport, and I think it's time that hockey admits that, you know, it's time to come out of the dark ages and move into the 21st century. That's what's on my mind this week.
The worst commissioner. Wow. Wow. Of course, Goodell's, you're not talking about him yet, so we'll wait for that when football season kicks in.
We'll wait for training camp.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more with the way Crosby's been abused and mistreated during, you know, each series. It's just shocking. That's one of the stars of your league, the face of the league.
And you know what I admire about Sid Crosby is he has always been called a crybaby. And you do not hear him whining, crying, or making excuses. He just simply seems to be able to direct his team into winning games. Yeah. And, I tip my hat for him for not being a crybaby.
Yeah, Philadelphia, that's all they call him, is a crybaby and a whiner. You talk to somebody from Philly. And
he may have been earlier in his career, but not so much now.
Hey, he was just standing up for what he thought was right, like the rest of the players. That's how I look at it.
Well, you know, I mean, you want to talk about crybabies. What about Mario Lemieux? I mean, he talked about it being a garage league, you know, because of the clutching.
People
and the grabbing.
Sort of miss that. Mm-hmm. They miss that. All right, what's on my mind? Penguin hockey. I predicted back-to-back. Smoking Jim, even you stole my line back-to-back. So thanks for watching the show, Smoking Jim Frazier. You're in our prayers to get back here as soon as you can. So they started the game out. Got a goal scored against them. They overturned that out of New York. Then one of my Neil, the real deal Neil, comes out with there's a delayed penalty, and he cross-checks somebody from behind, gets a second penalty, and the rest is history. We scored three goals in that first period, and it looked like it'd be a blowout. Then sure enough, they didn't score anything for 37 minutes. We'll talk some Penguin hockey there. But keep watching the Penguins. And I know they could do it. They made their goaltender look bad. You know, and they were saying how good he is. Rini, what a good goaltender he is. And he let a few in there and let five goals in. So
he doesn't seem to have much success against the Penguins.
Well, that quote comes up all the time, that he seems to not have that success. So good luck to the players coming back. Hornquist was back in action, which was good. So I'll be watching Penguins again, and that's what's on my mind. We're going to go to a break, and then we'll be back talking some trivia.
I've shown an interest in making home movies. Me and some buddies would just grab a camera and you just start making these videos, and then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore, it's something that you actually want to pursue, and there's this great facility right down the road, BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own, and one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know, but right here is everything that you need in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks, like anything that you'd want to use that you would need for a production, you have it right here. Like, it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and you know, let Dave be your guide.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show. But in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Chip's Trivia segment. And, you know, I like to try to keep my trivia consistent with what's going on in the sports world. So, what's going on here in the Pittsburgh sports scene other than the Stanley Cup Finals? So I think hockey and the Stanley Cup Finals are going to be the subject of my my trivia this week.
Brilliant.
Now, hockey history will be made for American coaches in the Stanley Cup Final. The cup has been handed out 89 times to the champion of the NHL since 1927. For the first time, two American coaches will face off in the final when the Nashville Predators' Peter Laviolette goes up against Penguins' Mike Sullivan. It's just the seventh time the cup will be won by a U.S.-born coach.
Wow, that's amazing.
Having two American coaches lead their team to the Stanley Cup Final highlights the continued growth and evolution of the sport in our country. Well, besides what Gary Bettman does to drag it down, but let's
little side.
USA Hockey Executive Director Dave Ogreen said, "We have more coaches in our country than ever before. Two of our very best are in the final. Laviolette and Sullivan are among six U.S.-born current coaches in the NHL, along with the Blue Jackets' John Tortorella, the Red Wings' Jeff Blashill, Devils' John Hines, and the Islanders' Doug White. The pair is already on an exclusive list of U.S. coaches to win the Cup. The very first Cup won by an American coach was Bill Stewart with the Chicago Blackhawks in 1938.
Wow.
Badger Bob Johnson with the Pittsburgh Penguins was the next American-born coach to win the Cup in 1991.
Wow.
Quite a stretch of Canadian dominance there in the sport that they created.
Yeah.
John Tortorella of the Tampa Bay Lightning in 2004. Peter Laviolette with the Hurricanes in 2006 won a Cup. Dan Bylsma with the Penguins in 2009. And Mike Sullivan with the Penguins last year. So of the six American-born coaches to have won the Stanley Cup, three of them did it with the Pittsburgh Penguins. Mike Sullivan, if he happens to win this Cup this year, will be the first Penguins coach to win more than one. And that would be actually be our fifth Stanley Cup, and I will get to that later on.
Wow.
Every other Cup-winning coach is Canadian. It took until 2012 for two U.S. captains to meet in the final when the Kings' Dustin Brown faced the Devils' Zach Parise, who raised the Cup in 2012 and 2014 and is one of just two U.S. captains to win it after the Stars' Darian Hatcher in 99. Moving on there to kind of update you all on how many teams have won multiple Stanley Cups?
Wow.
And where do the Penguins stand in this line? So the number one team with the most Stanley Cups in the most years in the league, the Montreal Canadiens, 23 Stanley Cup wins.
Wow.
The Toronto Maple Leafs have 13 wins, and I do not believe that they have won since the 60s. So 13 wins and quite a drought.
Yeah.
Quite a drought. The Detroit Red Wings are next with 11 Stanley Cups in 89 years, followed by the Boston Bruins and the Chicago Blackhawks, each with six, and the Edmonton Oilers with five. The Penguins come in just after that with four Stanley Cup wins. We could tie the Edmonton Oilers this year with another Cup win.
Let's do it.
Okay. Some facts about the Stanley Cup. I think that we might find these interesting. The first team to have its roster engraved on the Stanley Cup were the 1906-1907 Montreal Wanderers. The first woman to be engraved on the cup was Marguerite Norris, then president of the Detroit Red Wings,
wow,
in 1954 and 1955. There have been only four official engravers of the Stanley Cup. The first engravers comprised of two generations of the Peterson family with assistance from Fred Light Sr. They were followed by Doug Boffey, owner of Boffey Silversmiths of Montreal. The current engraver is Louis Saint-Jacques, who took over Boffey's engraving business and left the legacy of the shop's name in place. In 1919, the Spanish influenza epidemic forced,
wow,
the Canadiens and the Seattle Metropolitans to cancel their series, marking the first time the Stanley Cup was not awarded. Over the years, words like the Islanders or Islanders or Lays, what should have been Leafs, and Boston, which was spelled BQSTQN, have found their way onto the cup.
Crazy.
While more than a dozen players and coaches have had their names misspelled, former Montreal goaltender Jacques Plante had the misfortune of having his first name spelled four different ways in a span of 5 years.
Wow.
Edmonton Oilers owner Peter Pocklington had his father's name engraved onto the cup after the team won the 1984 championship. The NHL asked the official engravers to cover up the name, so they concealed it by hammering in a line of X's over
Get
his
on.
Name.
Wow.
In 1970, the Canadiens, Montreal, and this is in the 70s, the Montreal Canadiens won four Stanley Cups in a row with Scotty Bowman as their coach. Scotty Bowman helped the Penguins to win their second Stanley Cup.
Yeah. What a coach.
The Canadiens, or as the franchise is officially known, Le Club de Hockey Canadien, was founded in 1909-1910, making them the oldest team in professional hockey. During the 43-44 season, the Canadiens were nearly unbeatable, losing only five games season. And, of course, they won the cup that year. Now, there are actually three Stanley Cups. The original bowl is one, the authenticated cup, and the replica at the Hall of Fame. The original bowl was purchased by Lord Stanley and physically awarded to the champion for the first 71 years of competition. It is currently displayed at the Hockey Hall of Fame in Toronto. The Stanley Cup is named after Lord Stanley of Preston, a Governor General of Canada who created the trophy in 1892. It was awarded for the first time in 1893 to the Montreal Hockey Club in 1915. The original bowl was made of silver and had dimensions of 18.5 centimeters, that's just 7.28 inches, in height 11.4 inches in diameter. The current Stanley Cup, topped with a copy of the original bowl, is made of silver and nickel alloy. Today, it has a height of 35 inches and weighs 34 and a half pounds.
Wow.
So just some facts about the Stanley Cup that you may not have known, and how did it get its name as being the Stanley Cup. So one thing is definitely for certain. The seventh United States-born coach will win the Stanley Cup this year. And whichever coach does, it will be his second Stanley Cup victory. Laviolette with the Predators is one of two coaches, I believe, to have taken more than three teams to the finals.
Really?
Laviolette took Laviolette took the Carolina Hurricanes. Obviously, he's taken the Predators. And I forget what the other team was. The other coach that has done that amazing feat would have been Scotty Bowman. But, you know, the only thing that Laviolette says about taking three different teams to the Cup is, well, I guess I must have got fired a lot. So winning the Cup doesn't ensure you job
security.
You know, you just may have to change addresses every so often. So there's my Stanley Cup trivia. We're up 1-0 in this series. Big game tomorrow night. And Penguins definitely need to come out and perform better than they did yesterday. The performance wasn't up to par. We'll take the result every day of the week.
Oh.
A 5-3 win.
Yes.
But they certainly can play much better.
Thanks, Chip. I appreciate that knowledge. Learned a few things there. Hopefully you enjoyed that. My segment's now coming up. We appreciate that, Chip. On Location by Al Levine, the Talking Machine. Hey, thanks for the shout-outs from people throughout the last week or so that I've seen. Appreciate it. Glad you're watching the show, and we've got plenty more for you. Monday, we'll be at Hollywood Lanes for our On Location. We have a team called the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds. They actually have a football that they play with a frisbee, but they're not allowed to use a frisbee. They call it a disc. So the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds will be there. Adam Gardner is their general manager, and I think he plays. I think I noticed some of the Facebook messages that he's actually a player on the team. So we'll learn some things about that. Sindel Taylor has been on our show, Miss Pennsylvania. Her daughter Anastasia won Young Miss Pennsylvania as a young girl. She'll be on. I'll be doing her first interview on Pittsburgh Sportsline. Jody Velasquez, she'll be on our show. And Glenn Anderson, Smoking Jim, got a couple people booked, and he's one of them. So they'll be there. And hopefully, Smoking Jim Frazier, with your prayers, will make an entrance to Hollywood Lanes, 7:30 to 8:30, 2961 West Liberty Avenue. Check us out there, and we'll see you then. That's all I have for you. And we'll be talking Penguins a little bit later on after the commercial. Don't change that dial. Chief, have your dessert now.
Visit the Oliver Miller Homestead, an 18th century reenactment site located just off the circle on Corrigan Drive in South Park. Self-guided tours are available each Sunday from May 1st until December 8th from 1:30 until 4:30 p.m. with guides in 18th century garb located around the grounds to answer questions and to give information. Your tour will begin in a reproduction bank barn where displays give information on the movement west. You will also see the Miller Still and learn about the production of whiskey and the importance of it and of the whiskey rebellion to this area. Follow the Miller Trail up the path and visit the transportation shed, demonstration shed, forge, a reproduction log house, the original spring house, gardens, and finally end at the stone house. Each month, the guides host at least one special event. The homestead is also a great place for tours, tailored to the needs of school-age children, scout groups, or adults. Visit our website at www.olivermillerhomestead.org for a schedule for the year and much more information on the history of the Miller family, our organization, and pricing information.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show. But in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit.
Let's talk some Penguins, Chip. I was excited about the game last night. They went off to a 3-0 lead. Then all of a sudden, it was like a loss. 37 minutes, no shots.
You know,
it was just crazy. It was like
it was crazy. They got no shots on goal for over 37 minutes. But if you look at it, Nashville finally worked their way back into the game, but they weren't getting a tremendous amount of shots on goal.
They didn't look that good.
You know, and, the Penguins, the one thing that's been consistent about Mike Sullivan coach teams is they learn so much about themselves from each game that they play. And, you know, I can assure you that you're going to see a much crisper performance tomorrow evening.
Well, he keeps, branding them with do the right thing, play the right way.
It comes out
that they see their errors and there's no quit in them.
No, and they had a voluntary practice today, and more than half of the team skated. Now, the one person that was missing from practice, which makes you scratch your head, and we'll find out more about this tomorrow, is Matt Murray. Matt Murray got banged up a little bit. He got run into last night, and, they said it was just a normal off day for him, but you know how they are with hockey. Hockey's not like the NFL, They have to report the nature of the injuries and the degree of severity and all this other stuff. And, all they have to do in the NHL is that, he's injured somewhere between the tip of his head and the tip of his toes.
Well, it's upper body, lower body. Who knows what it is?
Upper body could be, anything from a concussion to an ingrown hair in the middle of your back. I don't know.
Or the 25 stitches he took to his head,
But, I like the place that the Penguins are in. I honestly do not believe that the Penguins will sweep the series. Nashville is an extremely good defensive hockey team. Probably four of the best defensemen in the league are skating on their, for them. But, the fact of the matter is, the Penguins were able to score some goals. Rene Pekka Rinne is their goaltender. Yeah. He seems to have a problem stopping pucks when it comes to the Penguins, and that was no more evident in the third period.
Sure.
When Gensel came in, the first shot the Penguins took on goal in 37 minutes went right past him.
Yeah.
You know, and I think maybe he kind of fell asleep a little bit, may have not been as sharp because he hadn't seen any pucks, you know. So, you know, that turned out to be the game winner. You know, that was a game that, you know, Nashville could have very easily stolen from us. And I believe that the Penguins stole it from the Predators.
Yeah.
Because I don't think the Penguins are going to perform like that tomorrow night. And it doesn't matter to me whatever netminders mind in the store. Equally right. as confident with Fleury after some rest as with Murray. So, you know,
either or. Happens. That's why we have them.
Yeah, well, you know.
They played at high levels.
And that's the reason why Jim Rutherford turned out to be quite the prophet in not getting rid of Marc-Andre and just trading him for the sake of trading him.
Right.
Because without both goaltenders, would the Penguins be in the finals right now? And I don't believe the answer to that question would be yes.
Oh, there's no way. Fleury did win us a few games.
Well,
for
you
sure.
know, Fleury won the Washington series without any question.
Yeah.
You know, that goes without saying. But, you know, Crosby with a couple of assists last night. Malkin scored a goal.
25 points for Malkin.
Yeah. Well, look at Jake Gensel. I mean, he scored 10 goals.
10
goals. And he has
a rookie,
and he hasn't even scored a goal since the second round.
Right, okay? Sixth game of Washington.
Yeah, so
I think it was. Yeah.
So you know the Penguins do have a lot of firepower, and you know they got to play the control the puck, keep the puck in the opponent's end, and you know.
I just hate that icing. I see a lot of those icing calls mm-hmm. that come out. That just stops the play and. Yeah, if they can get away from that a little bit.
Right. So we've got a big game Wednesday night at the paint can.
Yeah.
You know?
As you call it.
Yeah, as
we call it. PPG Paints.
The PPG Paint Arena.
They took over the sponsorship there. So.
They paid good money for it, so, you know, let them have their way.
Yeah, they got it. Mm-hmm. No doubt about it. But I'm excited about it. I predict it'll go 7 games. It's not going to be a sweep. Anything can happen. We've seen that already in a couple of these series. So I'm just going
well, you know,
right there.
And let's not lose sight of the fact that you know the Chicago Blackhawks were arguably the best team in the Western Conference.
Yeah.
And the Nashville Predators swept them in 4 games. Okay. So you know the Nashville Predators are not here by accident. And I think of all of the professional sports. I think the hardest championship trophy to win is the Stanley Cup.
Ah, there's no
4
doubt.
Rounds of, you know, 7 game series
plus overtime.
And it is a much more physical game than basketball. You know, and it's a much faster game than basketball. And the day in and day out grind, they don't get as much time off as the other sports.
Right.
And to win their playoffs, it means you got to play for 2 months. Every other day, you know, the NFL, you know, if you get that first round bye, you play 2 games and you're playing for the championship.
Yeah.
You know, sure, it's a one and done tournament, but, you know, you're getting a week off in between games. And in a lot of cases, you're getting 2 weeks off between the conference championship.
Everybody's injured at this point of the season.
Oh, yes, they are.
So they can heal up, and that makes a big difference. Hockey, it's a little faster.
Hockey
a little
players,
more problems.
Hockey players are sick. They have a bone sticking through the skin. They just get some duct tape and
they're getting hit in the head and the face with pucks, and they're coming back in with stitches.
Mm-hmm.
Their face is all stitched up.
Yeah,
so I give them a lot of credit.
Rick Tocchet came back into the game with
a broken jaw. Yeah.
And scored.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
what a player.
You know, they're tougher than most is what I know about hockey players. So.
Yeah, as long as they stay away from those concussions and fights.
One of the interesting things that I've found is that Chris Letang, 7 weeks ago, had surgery on his neck. And he is in the locker room, and he is coaching the players.
Wow.
And adding his insight from a player's perspective to what he's seeing in the
press
box. So Letang is contributing, even though he's not contributing on the ice. And the one thing that he said when it was announced that he was going to miss the entire playoffs because of the surgery he's going to have on his neck, he said that he still believed that the Penguins could win the Cup without him, when everybody else and all the experts said that there's no way that that could happen. And three wins away from it, so.
Hey, I'm happy to be watching them.
You know, yeah. The hardest game to win is the fourth game in the final series. So I'd like to see the Penguins go up 2-0, go down, maybe split one in Nashville and then come back. And I'd love to see them raise the Cup here at the paint can.
Well,
every
it's
time
rare.
We've won,
it's a rarity
we've won
in
it on
Pittsburgh.
The road.
To win a championship at home.
Last
That's
one,
a rare.
Last one was the year I was born.
Yeah.
You know? That's interesting that we mentioned that.
Yeah.
Because, you know,
you don't see it.
I should have mentioned this in my trivia segment, and I know we're talking Penguins. We're going to get on to the Pirates. But then, while this is still fresh in my brain, Harvey Haddock's just celebrated the anniversary of his 13-inning no-hit game that he lost. He lost a no-hitter in the top of the 13th inning.
Yeah.
And do you know who the winning pitcher was in the 1960 World Series Game 7?
I forget.
Harvey Haddock's.
Wow.
I heard that trivia.
Now, that's some good trivia, folks. You got a bonus, double bonus.
A double bonus. While we were talking Penguins, I threw some Pirate trivia in there, but I had to because, you know, my brain just goes, and sometimes
it got stats
it gets,
in there.
It gets lost in there.
They're
and
coming out.
It takes a while for it to come back around.
We pulled that out. Somehow we got it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the Penguins will have more on that from before. I predicted back-to-back. I'm still on that bandwagon. I believe it'll happen.
Hey,
they got
you know
the
what?
Players and the team.
Right now I've got the Eastern Conference Champions hat on. Okay, well.
You look good in that hat.
Maybe next week. There'll be Stanley Cup champion hat on my head.
That could happen.
As well as a T-shirt, because I like to represent. I got to represent. You know, I support my local teams. I'm a homer. What can I say?
Me too. I bleed black and gold all the time. Speaking of black and gold, so Kutch got dropped in the lineup, and he hits a walk-off home run.
Well, you know, and it's funny that last year, Kutch got benched for three games when they were in Atlanta. And they were back down in Atlanta, and Clint Hurdle put him on the bench again because he had dropped to the point where he was batting 200.
Yeah, he's on which that Mendoza
is the,
line.
The ubiquitous Mendoza line. And I think even Andrew McCutchen realized that he was pressing, putting too much pressure on himself, and things were just getting worse. You take the pressure off of him for being in the three-hole. And the three-hole is supposed to be your team's best hitter, your most productive hitter.
Getting on
your
base.
RBI guy, you know, and he had plenty of opportunities for RBIs and everything, and he kept on coming up short. Now, I don't know if this means that, you know, Andrew McCutchen's skills have deteriorated to the point that, you know, we can't ever expect him to be the MVP that he was for us in 2013. I kind of anticipated him having a big bounce back year this year, and it hasn't worked out that way yet. But that all being said, dropped him down into the six hole, and all of a sudden he's relaxed at bat, and he's starting to be a little bit more productive. And it's a step in the right direction. You know, last night he hit a walk-off home run, hit it to like right center field. When Andrew McCutchen is hitting the ball the way Andrew McCutchen can hit the ball, he's hitting the ball to right center. He's hitting the ball to left center.
Oh, he sprays it all over the field.
And he's hitting it with authority. And, we're starting to see some signs of that. But, you know, he's got a long way to go. He's got a long way to go.
Yeah.
And the Pirates are still kind of bitten by the injury bug. They lost Chris Stewart last night on the disabled list again now with a hamstring issue. Polanco carted off the field with a sprained ankle. It's not broken. He's not been put on the disabled list, which begs us to think if he does get put on the DL, this may be the chance the Pirates have to take a look at Austin Meadows. Now, Austin Meadows, everybody was wondering why he didn't come up north with the team. He wasn't quite ready, and he wasn't performing well in Triple A the first month of the season. However, look what happened in the second month of the season. Right now, he is, out of his last 18 at-bats, he's got 10 hits. He's on fire. This is a kid that could be one of the future star outfielders for the Pirates.
Hopefully.
And because of the injury issues and the stupidity issues on Starling Marte's part, Austin Meadows may get a chance to make his major league debut sooner than any of us anticipated. And here's going to be the thing. Once he comes up and he starts performing, you know, will we be able to send him back down?
Yeah.
Because, you know, hey.
Good question.
You got to play the players that are producing.
Yeah.
You know, and.
Well, like, look at Adam Frazier. Smoking Jim's favorite player, but
Adam Frazier,
he's hitting like 500 against left-handers.
Yeah, he's doing real well. They sat him down for tonight because he played, you know, after coming off the DL, he played three games. He had a day off. Then he played seven games in 7 days. And what Clint Hurdle saw in him Sunday night, he wanted him to get a chance to play on national TV. But he saw fatigue, okay? And this is a young man who's not yet used to the rigors and the wear and tear of Major League Baseball. So, you know, they
move him around to different positions.
And,
so
and you definitely
ball.
Get more work when you play in outfield than you do in the infield.
Yeah.
Because you're chasing down fly balls all day long. So Adam Frazier's getting a little bit of a break. We've got Ivan Nova on the mound tonight against the Arizona Diamondbacks.
Yeah.
And, you know, Nova has two complete games already this year and pitched 8 1/3 innings of quality baseball the other day. Couldn't close out the Braves. They started getting the bat on the ball against him. You know, so we still were able to win that game. But Ivan Nova has the highest percentage of strikes thrown and the fewest walks, I believe, of any
starter off the charts
in the National League right now.
Yeah.
And he was really a great acquisition last summer, but even better of a job of signing him.
Yeah, for this year.
And not overpaying for him.
Yeah.
You know, because that's the one thing that the Pirates need to be very cautious about is, you know, just because you have money doesn't mean that you spend it foolishly.
Yeah, we're not the Yankees. We don't have the
we don't print
dollars.
Money.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we don't have
money.
The billion-dollar contracts with TV.
Yeah. So, you know, in looking at the way the Pirates are performing right now, a lot of people have written the Pirates off. I am always the eternal optimist and a diehard Pirates fan. We're only 3.5 games out of first place right now.
It's unbelievable.
And do you realize that the Central Division in the National League over the last 5 years has probably been the best division in baseball? And there is only one team in the National League Central Division that has a record above 500. That's the Milwaukee Brewers.
And they're in
27
first place.
And 24.
They're in first place.
And they're in first place. And so right now, the field's wide open. The Cardinals are not playing like the Cardinals. And, Flash in the Plan clubs, they've lost 4 in a row. Nowhere near the team that they were last year, but they have all the same pieces. Maybe the amount of
they
money...
They got to spend more money.
Maybe the amount of money you spend doesn't have anything to do with the way players perform on the field. But, so I'm going to sit back and enjoy the ride. I'm not going to dwell on all the negatives. I'm going to look at the positives with the Pirates this year. We're going to have a competitive season. And you know what?
Can happen.
We are by no means out of it. And, you know, and if that bonehead Starling Marte comes back and is able to perform and to help the team, that would be great if he could help us get to the postseason. It's such a shame that we won't be able to utilize his skills.
He won't be able to play
in the postseason. And you know, I'm interesting to see how he handles coming back and the kind of reception that he's going
to
get.
It'll be interesting to see how the fans are.
Well, like
how much more disappointed
like
can you be?
Like the guy said, I'm not very much into booing and creating big public displays. You know, when Barry Bonds was here after the 2014 opener, I'm not a Barry Bonds fan. Did I boo him? No. Did I applaud him? No. I just was...
Let it go.
I was just silent, you know? And I will do the same with Marte, and if he starts producing, yes, I will cheer when he produces. And if he doesn't produce, My silence will be my bow.
There you go. Well, we'll see what happens.
We'll see what happens. I just hope that the quality of a player that he was prior wasn't the result of the PEDs, and that
good point.
He comes back, and he could be a quality major leaguer. So
yeah. Well, I'm hopeful too. And then how about John Jaso the other night, tied up the game in the ninth inning?
Here's the thing.
Then in the 10th inning, he drives in the winning run.
John Jaso has...
how cool was that?
...has raised his batting average almost 60 points to just slightly over 200. He had started off the year horrendously.
Oh.
And, and baseball's cyclical like this. You go through periods where you can't hit.
Just keep him out of right field for a little bit.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Where else are you going to play him? I mean, right now, with the, personally myself, Josh Bell, if I was the manager, Josh Bell is my number four batter. He's my first baseman every day of the week. Period. I'm not platooning him with nobody.
All right.
Give him a chance to play the position. The kid's got some stick and hit from the right and the left side.
Yeah. Got some power.
You've got this gift in Gope. I love the way he plays second base. He's a great defensive player. I would, I would shuttle Josh Harrison and Freeze in and out of third base. Josh Harrison is still able to play outfield. Freeze is a good, solid Major League third baseman. Yeah. Jordy Mercer is as good a shortstop as you need in the major leagues, okay?
Yeah, he's very good.
The outfield, boy, what a mess.
Yeah.
We came north.
Who would think?
We came north and we thought, okay, we've got three solid outfielders. The wheels fell off that bus bad. And who knows what's going to happen with Gong. I have a feeling we're not going to see him this year.
It doesn't look good.
No. And, once again, stupidity played a big part in what he's done.
They're upholding his sentences, so that's not a good sign.
Well, in a way it's good to see something like that because, the privileged few always seem to get away with everything, and the average regular Joe is the one that has to suffer sentences.
Very true.
The rules need to apply to everybody equally. So,
he's caught up into the system for sure because of his discretions.
He got nobody to blame but himself.
Nah,
he had the world in the palm of his hand, and he blew it. What, for a drink?
Yeah.
And it doesn't seem
to
make sense to me.
Yeah, quite a few drinks.
More than a few, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
well, we will see what happens with that. But we saw some exciting baseball.
No, we did see some exciting baseball out of him, and he was a big part of our plans for success this year.
Power-wise, too.
Just the fact that he's not here, it's disturbing. But you know what? Nobody's feeling sorry for the Pirates. And you know what? There's still 162 games in this season, and the Pirates are going to field a team. And, again, tip my hat to Hurdle. One of the things that does drive me up a wall about him is that nobody's got a set position or a set spot in the batting order. With the exception of McCutchen up until last week,
You
knew every day he was going to be penciled in the third spot.
Right.
But now
he's
playing mix and match and juggling players here and there. And, they're finding a way to win games.
Yeah, they are, which is exciting to see.
They're losing some games that they could have won, but, they are by no means out of it. Jameson Taillon pitched in Altoona day before yesterday.
Oh, okay.
He pitched three innings. His limit was 50 pitches. He didn't hit 50 pitches. I think he had four or five strikeouts. Pitched very well. No runs given up.
Good.
And he's going to be throwing a bullpen session tomorrow. And I would expect that sometime in the month of June that we should see Jameson Taillon back on the mound. He was pitching very well. He was pitching well. Garrett Cole's pitched well, but here's the problem Garrett Cole's had this year. Even though he hasn't been getting any run support.
None.
So far, he has set a career high for home runs given up in a season with 12. It's May 30th.
Right.
Okay? We're 2 months into the season, and
it's a lot of home runs.
That's a lot of home runs, but, he's still, his ERA's down. And he's pitching solid.
Just so he's throwing the single home runs.
He's keeping the Pirates in games, but, the unfortunate part is the offense has been.
Well, I've noticed that Gerrit Cole has one bad inning, maybe two bad innings, and that cost him.
The other night he gave up three home runs, and we still ended up winning the game. But
it puts it in jeopardy. Definitely.
Yes, it definitely puts it in jeopardy.
Yeah, and he does hold he's got that 100 mile per hour fastball that comes out, 99, 100.
Well, you know one of the things.
What a talent he has.
That I was listening to some color guys talking about the way certain pitchers pitch. And, you know, they were talking about adjusting the speed of your pitch. Just because you could throw a ball at 98 miles an hour, maybe if he throws the pitch at 96 miles an hour, it has a little more movement at the
end. Sure.
Okay? And what's happening is
it's the movement that counts. A straight pitch, they'll catch up to.
He's throwing it through the rotation, and you're not getting the late movement on it. Maybe that's part of what is going on with him, but you know what? I think he's got a pretty good grasp of everything. He seems to be healthy this year.
Yeah.
And, you know, if we can get some run support for him, you know, Gerrit Cole, I mean, we still have him after this year. We still have him for two more years.
Right.
So, you know, utilize him to the best of his abilities.
Put it like this. I know other teams are eyeing him up because he would be great to their staffs.
Right. But in the kind of year that we're having this year, you know, you three and a half games out, And as bad as the season has been to this point,
it's a blessing.
You know, you're not out of it. I mean, I don't think at this point we need to be sellers. I mean,
cooler heads will prevail for sure.
Right. I mean, you don't want a knee-jerk reaction. I don't know if this is, you know, we've got McCutchen for this year, we've got him for next year. Okay. So, you know, is this going to be the summer that we try trading him, or is it going to be next summer?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we know that McCutchen's probably not going to finish his career here. I would love to see him do that, but that's not the environment
doesn't
of professional
seem that way.
Baseball that we see in the world today. So all I can say is I'm going to enjoy the team that they field each and every night. I'm going to cheer for the guys in the Bucco uniforms.
Yes.
And
go from there.
We'll see what happens. We've got four more months of baseball. Long way to go. And
they've been surprising this year at times.
Crazier things have happened.
Oh, yeah.
Like, look at this. The Cubs won a World Series.
Right.
You know? I mean, who would have ever thought?
I know I wouldn't. I thought they would have come out strong, just like I thought the Pirates would have, you know, a better record this year, too. Of course, a couple things happened with players, and, you know, that hurts.
Yeah, you know, I mean, and every team has these problems. You know, ours are much more obvious to us because we live and die with the team, you know. We wake up in the morning talking Pirates. We go to bed at night talking Pirates. So.
Yeah, and we're still talking them now.
And I'll keep talking as long as I've got breath in my body.
Go Buccos. Hey, did you see Big Ben at the Penguin game stirring people
up? Yeah, I saw Ben, and I like how Miss Drama Queen has, well, you know, I'm only committing to playing this year, you know. So, hey, do you need attention that bad? Here's what. Go out and win football games. You get all the attention that you want. You know, you blew your chance of being, you know, all over magazines and a pitch man for this.
Right.
And that and the other thing. You had your chance to do that. You blew it. So now, you know, the only way you're going to get people to pay attention
to
you.
He's getting some attention, waving the Penguin gear, getting the fans. You know, they come out on the ice at the beginning of the game.
I'm surprised Gerrit Cole wasn't there because he's a big Penguin fan, too.
And he was resting his arm.
Yeah, and I'll tell
you what. He didn't want to twirl his arm.
When the Penguins won Game 7 last week, and I'll tell you what, double overtime, and that was...
That's a monster.
I'm telling you what, that game could have gone either way.
Yeah.
And you got to tip your hat to Ottawa, and the Penguins came out a winner in double overtime, and that could have gone the other way, but that all being said, and you know, one thing I love about our local sports teams is they support one another.
Yeah.
Without any question.
No, I brought it up because it's nice to see that support, you know. Mm-hmm. Big Ben did come out and do it for whatever reason, whether it's drama or not. That's just how he is.
Well,
he operates that way. Anybody remembers when he first come to town? Same type of things, how he is.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you know, hey, you know, love him or hate him, and I know more people hate him than love him, you know, because of the way he acted when he was younger, and I guess he saw the error in his ways.
Well, and now he's a family man with three kids.
Well, you know, but, you know, has he really changed, or has he learned to disguise it better? I don't know. I'm a bit cynical. What can I say?
Here's what I'll say. He's following the Steeler orders.
And, well, you know what? They
How's
said
that?
They told him, you got $100 million contract. You want to get a second one. Here's the things that you have to do.
Well, I know the Rooneys weren't happy with him. They had him get married or figure something out like that. And the kids, he's got
Speaking
three
of
now.
The Rooneys, you know, very, very sad that Dan Rooney passed. And I know that Dan Rooney was friends with Jim Frazier. And I remember Jim asking me a number of times to pray for him because he thought Dan was in failing health. One of the things that really upset me about the passing of Dan Rooney is that, you know, you've got the four-time Super Bowl winning quarterback of the Pittsburgh Steelers of the 70s, Terry Bradshaw, never heard a peep, never made a pilgrimage to Pittsburgh, never expressed his gratitude for what the Rooneys had done for him. Nobody would even know who Terry Bradshaw is if it wasn't for the Rooney family.
Yeah.
You know, and he did the same thing with Chuck Knoll. And I don't think there is a professional athlete that has ever played in this city that I have less respect for right now than Terry Bradshaw. That's a strong statement from me. You know,
I wasn't expecting it, but that was strong.
Well, you know, I don't care what he has to say. And you know what will happen when he gets the TV camera on him this fall? He's going to shed a tear and give this eulogy, and I'm going to want to stuff a sock in his mouth because, you know, he's just so disingenuous.
Yeah.
I don't believe that he has a sincere bone in his body. But I don't know if it bothered anybody else, but I was, you know, I kept saying, you know, I haven't heard a tweet. I haven't seen a post. I haven't even, you know.
There was not even a sly comment or a little comment at all.
Nothing.
It is shocking. It truly is for what he's done.
Well, that just shows you what kind of class he's gotten. And in my mind's eye, that's none at all.
Well, that's in the past, and God bless him for all that. Mm-hmm. We're just moving forward. Go Steelers. We'll have some Steeler talk when Smoking Jim comes back,
I'm sure.
Yes, we
will. I want to dig into this year's draft class.
I want to know about that long snapper.
Yeah, well, I know that was Jim's five-star, you know.
That was his ultimate pick.
Led pipe lock or whatever.
Cinch, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
No, he comes up with a few of those. We miss our buddy Smoking Jim Frazier, in case you didn't know. He's not on here. Hoping next week is a possibility. I want to thank all of you for watching us. Thanks to Devin Shea and Ethan in the control room. Thanks, Chip Hainer, for all you do for the show. I appreciate it. I'm Al Levine, the Talking Machine. We appreciate every one of you, and we've been doing this 5 years because of our fans. Plus, I like to talk, so you can tell that. So enjoy that. Chip brings out plenty of trivia things, which we have a strong support there. And this is it for tonight. Thanks for watching us Tuesday night. Go Pens tomorrow night. And please stay Joey Strong.